This video is brought to you by my fantastic supporters over at Patreon. Go to patreon.com/TJTheEmperor to find out how you can support the channel. Hi, friends. This is
part 5
of the complete Xenogears reference guide. As always, if you notice anything I forgot or got wrong, leave me a comment about it, and if I get enough of them, I'll make an addendum video and give you credit for whatever you found. Alright, enjoy the video. We find Krellian having another conversation with the Gazelle Ministry. He reveals that the Mother exists among the Lambs, and that they didn't realize it until now because her persona only appears once she's reached a certain age. Persona is another term from Jungian psychology, used to denote the aspect of our personality that the self presents to the world in order to be accepted by society. The Mother, likewise, is another Jungian term, one of the archetypes embodying love and protection. The greater significance of this will have to wait until later. Now that the war between Ave and Kislev is over, the party switches their focus to infiltrating Solaris. The only way to do this is to destroy the gates, keeping it hidden from the rest of the world. One of the gates, they discover, is hidden in a place called Sargasso Point. Sargasso Point is named after an actual region of the Atlantic Ocean called the Sargasso Sea, so named for the sargassum seaweed that's found there. At Sargasso Point, they run into two new characters. The first is Rotan, a henchman working for Krellian. The name Rotan is a reference to a type of palm plant. However, this is another instance where the name was changed for the English localization. In Japanese, Rotan is called Kenren, and this is a reference to, believe it or not, a character from Kazuya Minakura's manga series, Sayuki. I'm assuming that someone on the development staff must have been a fan of that manga. Why Richard Honeywood felt the need to change the name, however, I'm less sure of. Sure, most people probably wouldn't catch the Sayuki reference, especially in 1998, but really, are they any more likely to catch the reference to a name of a weird-sounding plant? Moving on, the second new character is one we've sort of encountered before, that little girl nanomachine colony from Zeboim, Emeralda. She pilots a gear called Crescens, and Crescens may be one of the most puzzling references in the entire game. Crescens is the name of a figure in the New Testament, but all we really know about him is that he was an associate of St. Paul and that he was sent to minister in the Roman province of Galatia, in what's now Turkey. I don't have the slightest idea why her gear should be named after this figure. To jump ahead, the party manages to destroy the gates, expose Solaris, and infiltrate the country. While there, Faye discovers a man who looks almost identical to his old friend Timothy. It isn't really Timothy, but another man named Samson. Samson is another biblical figure, one of the judges from the biblical Book of Judges, a man who had super strength as long as he kept his hair long, but whose secret was eventually betrayed by his Philistine wife Delilah. Why this man is named after Samson is uncertain, aside from the fact that he was apparently a participant in the same tournament in Ave that Faye competed in, although he can't even claim to be that strong, since he says he lost in the first round. While we're on the subject of uncertainties, neither the game nor Perfect Works makes clear why Samson looks so similar to Timothy. While Faye and Ellie are wandering around Solaris, they can encounter a couple references that are there as goofy parodies of our world. One of the kids says he wants a pair of pogo shoes. These are likely a reference to moon shoes, a toy that's been manufactured in some form or fashion since the 1950s. They're essentially shoes that contain springs, allowing the wearer to jump higher. There's also a reference to Ticketmeister, obviously a parallel to Ticketmaster, and the fact that Solaris allows Ticketmaster to exist within their borders is further proof of their status as the game's villains. One last reference. One of the houses has a poster on the wall of Final Fantasy VII heroine Tifa Lockhart, another reminder of the fact that Xenogears was supposed to be Final Fantasy VII before becoming its own property. Faye and Ellie find their way to Arbot Plaza to watch a dedication ceremony hosted by Krellian and Emperor Kane. Arbot is a reference to Araboth, the name of the highest of the seven heavens where the throne of God is said to be housed. Again, it says something about how Solaris views itself that they're willing to give their plaza a name like that. Kane gives a speech to his adoring subjects, easing their mind by saying the destruction of the gates was foreordained, and that he's opened the door to Mahanan, the place where God rests. He turns the mic over to Krellian, who declares that the five perpetrators of the gate attacks, members of your party, naturally, have been captured, and will be disposed of in the Soylent system. The Soylent System is another reference, one of the most infamous in the entire game, but I'm gonna wait a minute before I go into it. After the speech, Faye and Ellie stop by Ellie's house, where Faye meets her parents, Eric and Medina. Medina is probably a reference to the name of one of the most holy cities in Islam, where the Prophet Muhammad is buried. I don't think the name has any greater significance to her character, and the same can be said for Eric's name, although Eric at least continues the tradition of borrowing names from notable psychoanalysts. There are actually two that could be referenced here. Eric Fromm, who among other things studied the psychological effects of freedom in light of the aftermath of the Nazi regime, and Erich Neumann, a student of Jung who wrote extensively on the development of consciousness. Eventually, Faye and Ellie reconvene with Chiton, who's somehow still able to wander through the depths of Solaris without being detected. Chiton uses this freedom to guide Faye and Ellie through Solaris's dark underbelly, including the aforementioned Soylent System. And here we find that the Soylent System, Shock of Shocks, is a facility that creates food and medicine out of people. Again, this is one of the most infamous references in the entire game, because for most it's just so obvious. It's named for the 1973 sci-fi film Soylent Green, in which the pivotal twist is the fact that
Soylent Green is people!
Though everyone in the English-speaking world probably recognized the reference, and therefore predicted the twist in Xenogears, the same cannot be said of the Japanese fans. Soylent Green was not as well known in that country, so the Japanese were probably genuinely surprised by what Chiton showed them. Afterwards, Chiton brings them to another facility, where he reveals the first human beings, Emperor Kane and the members of the Gazelle Ministry, were born there 10,000 years ago. He further reveals another truth about the Soylent System. Part of its function is to create new physical bodies for the Gazelle Ministry, who lost them 500 years ago in a catastrophe called the Diabolos Invasion. We don't know who or what the Diabolos are at this point, but we can at least discuss the name. It's the Greek word commonly translated as devil. At this point, Ellie confronts Chiton. How the hell is it possible that he knows so much of what feels like forbidden knowledge? He doesn't answer. The lights are cut, and when we next see Faye, he's confined in a room with TV screens everywhere. On one of the screens, Chiton appears with the Soul 9000, only the Gazelle Ministry does not introduce him as Chiton. He is instead called Hugo Richto, Guardian Angel of Solaris. Now, we've heard the name Hugo before, many of the other characters from Solaris have called him that, but Richto is a new one. Unfortunately, this is another case where romanization obscures meaning. The way it's spelled, R-I-C-D-E-A-U, makes it look French, but it's not. It should more appropriately be spelled R-I-K-U-D-O, Richto. This is a reference to the six realms of the Buddhist tradition, the goal of that tradition being to achieve enlightenment by escaping the cycle of death and rebirth in those worlds. I argue that this name is extremely significant to his character, but I need to wait a couple more minutes to discuss that significance, so just bear with me. The Ministry proceeds to spoil their plans, to use the other party members, who all contain the Animus Factor, as their new physical bodies, as well as to terminate Faye himself. The end goal of all this? To resurrect God, join him in Mahanan, and use Mahanan as an ark to return home, for human beings actually come from an alien world. I feel like I should apologize, as there aren't any references to explain here, but this exposition is essential to understand subsequent references we'll encounter later in the game. The scene then shifts to Ellie, who's being held captive by Krellian. Like the Gazelle Ministry before him, Krellian tells Ellie his plans, specifically with regards to his obsession with nanomachines. His purpose in using nanomachines was to be able to analyze information found in people's introns, introns being the part of a gene that isn't expressed in mature RNA. The information Krellian is looking for is in a piece of genetic information called the Urobilis ring. Urobilis probably should be romanized as Ouroboros, the symbol of the snake eating its own tail that's long been used as a symbol for infinity, eternity, and rebirth. What this means in Xenogears world is something else that's gonna have to wait, but before I move on, I need to point out, the spelling of Ouroboros as Urobilis has been used, to my knowledge, in one other piece of media, and coincidentally, it's another PlayStation RPG from the late 90s, The Legend of Dragoon. Urobilis is the name of the snake boss fought by Dart, Levitz, and Shauna in the Limestone Cave. I know this doesn't have anything to do with Xenogears itself, but as an RPG fan, I had to mention it. Moving back to Chiton and Faye, Chiton proceeds to basically obliterate Faye psychologically, in the process summoning Id, confirming that Faye and Id are in fact the same person. Faye is eventually freed from his captivity by Bart, Billy, and Chiton? Okay, what the hell is going on here? Chiton is quick to fill in the blanks. He was essentially acting as a double agent, serving as ally to Krellian and the Ministry in order to sneak into the research facility and fully remove the party's limiters, as well as bring the true horrors of the Salarian state to light, for you cannot know the good unless you first understand the evil. As if that weren't enough, Chitan was also working in the shadows with Emperor Kane, who seems to have turned his back on Krellian and the Gazel Ministry, for the express purpose of determining whether Faye, and by extension Id, is a danger to their goals. To accomplish all this, deception was unavoidable. Here, finally, we can understand the significance of Chitan's names, both his alias Chitan and his true last name, Rikudo. I'll start with Rikudo, the six realms of Buddhism meant to be overcome to achieve enlightenment. Now that we know the full extent of Solaris' plans, we can see what a nightmare the world they've engineered really is. A shadowy cabal pulls the strings of most of the world's major powers, who see all people who live on the surface as little more than raw materials to further their twisted desires, who've organized a society where only those at the very, very top of the pyramid benefit in any form, materially or spiritually. Under such a despairing regime, the desire to escape the world they've created, to achieve some sort of enlightenment, is the only intelligent decision one can take. The name Rikudo, then, is perfectly fitting for Chitan, who in fact is fighting harder than anyone to achieve that enlightenment. Likewise, Chitan also seems to be a perfectly fitting name. Remember when we first introduced Chitan way back in Lahan Village, and we discussed how his name suggests Shaitan, the Arabic word for devil? Viewing Chitan as a satanic figure actually works in multiple ways. The traditional view of Satan, as alluded to in the Bible and made explicit in John Milton's Paradise Lost, is that of an angel who rebelled against God and spent the rest of his immortal life attempting to dethrone him in revenge. The Gazel Ministry view themselves as gods, both metaphorically, based on how their social structure is organized, but as we now know, literally as well. In such a world, Chitan is Satan, the angel in active rebellion against the gods of Solaris. But it's not just this traditional view that resonates with Chitan's character. Consider, in the Gnostic tradition, a common way of interpreting the Garden of Eden story is to view the serpent, who in the traditional Christian interpretation is Satan himself, not as a figure of evil, but as a redeemer, one who has been sent by the transcendent alien god to give Adam and Eve divine knowledge. Again, this story resonates with Chitan very well. His entire plan has been to give the party, Faye especially, knowledge of the truth in order to assist them in their quest to break the shackles of the world's false gods. Alright, we spent enough time on this. The end of the journey to Solaris sees one insane thing happen after another. Groff makes a return appearance, Hammer turns traitor after being seduced by Krellian's promise of power, Faye transforms into Id again, Ramses becomes completely unhinged, and Solaris is blown to smithereens. Once the smoke clears, the party reconvenes in Shavat, where Chitan fills in more of the blanks on what exactly Id is. Faye, as it turns out, suffers from dissociative identity disorder, and therefore has a number of split personalities. The Faye that we know has really only existed since he was brought to Lahan 3 years ago. The core personality is a mysterious entity known only as the Coward. In between those two, subordinate to the Coward but dominant over Faye, is Id. The one reference I have to discuss here concerns the name Dissociative Identity Disorder, or DID. I have to give Takahashi and Tanaka credit in using this name, as opposed to the more commonly used Multiple Personality Disorder. MPD was renamed to DID with the publication of the DSM-IV in 1994, only 4 years before Xenogears was released. It shows that they were actively aware of recent developments in mental health treatment, and for that they deserve commendation. Id's power proves too dangerous to ignore, and the rulers of Shavat, with the rest of the party seemingly in agreement, condemn Faye to be frozen in carbonite. This is, of course, another Star Wars reference. Han Solo was famously frozen in carbonite at the end of The Empire Strikes Back. There's one major difference, though. Han was frozen as an experiment, to test the lethality of the carbonite freezing process. With Faye, this is not the case. Shavat's only concern is sealing Id's power at any cost. Ellie seems to be the only one who's horrified by what's transpiring, and arranges to break Faye out of prison. She's successful, and in fact she's assisted by the rest of the party, who apologize for their complicity in condemning Faye to carbonite freezing. The two fly off, but are pursued by Ramses, still fully unhinged and newly equipped with an Omnigear, Vendetta. Ramses' attack destroys Veltal and critically wounds Ellie. Alone in a forest, Faye promises to save Ellie, while Groff watches silently in the background. And on that ominous note, Disc 1 of Xenogears is finally over. Holy fuck, that was a lot, and that was just Disc 1. We have a whole nother disc to get through, but you know what? We're going to save that for the next time.
Of life goes on.